Hello everybody and welcome back to another Blender Made Easy tutorial. Today I'm going to be showing you how to create a fluid particle system using Mantaflow. In previous versions of Blender, what you had to do to create something similar to this was to use the fluid particles in the particle system. This was not very good and most of the time it didn't really work, and your simulation would look something like this. Now though, with the introduction of Mantaflow, it makes it super easy to create a particle fluid simulation. Let's get started by adding in our object and creating the simulation. So for this default cube, we're going to scale it up. Once again, we're going to keep it in the scene. We're not going to delete it because default cubes matter. From there, we can start working on the simulation. We'll work on the domain last, so with this obstacle right here, I'll go over to the Physics tab, enable Fluid, and set the type over to Effector. It's already on collision, so that's all we need to do. For the fluid, select it, select fluid, and set the type over to flow. The flow type we need to change to liquid, and then the flow behavior I'm going to leave as geometry. And now for the domain, go ahead and select it, enable fluid, and set the type over to domain. Of course, for the domain type, we're going to select liquid. Here we can get into the settings and change how the simulation looks. The first thing that we'll do is change the time scale. This controls the speed of the simulation, and normally with Mantaflow it looks really fast, so we're going to set this down to a value of 0.5. The time steps maximum and minimum values controls how many time steps will be in between frames. This will help smooth out the simulation and also make it look a little bit better. We're going to bring up the minimum to a value of 2. And now let's get on to the liquid. If this box is unchecked, make sure you check that on, and here we can see a lot of different settings. Let's go through these settings and I'll be describing exactly what they do and how they change the simulation. The first one that we have here is the flip ratio. This controls the amount of splashes and how big the simulation will look. Higher values will make the simulation look bigger with bigger splashes, and lower values will make the simulation look smaller with less splashes. Underneath that we have the particle radius. The higher you set this to, the more particles will be spread out from each other. The lower you set this to, the particles will be a lot closer. The maximum and minimum values right here controls how many particles are going to be in a certain grid cell. Mantaflow is split up into cells, and this value controls how many particles are going to be in each one. This value normally fluctuates depending on the simulation, so normally the default values work perfectly fine. The particle sampling controls how many are going to be in a simulation. The higher you set this to, the more particles will be in your simulation, but it will take a lot longer to bake, and sometimes it even crashes if you set this up to a higher number. For this simulation, I'm going to bring it down to 1. The narrow bandwidth. This is what we need to change. This controls the bandwidth of the fluid particles. Normally, when you just bake in a simulation, you will see a thin line of particles on the top. This controls how big that line is. With a value of about 10, this will fill up the entire simulation. So that is what we're going to do. We're going to set that to 10, and then for the randomness, I'm going to bring this up to a value of 0.4, and this will give the particles some randomness so they don't look as uniform. And that's basically all we really need to do for the simulation. What we are going to change is the end frame right here. I'm going to bring this up to a value of 150. From there, we can go ahead and save our project if we haven't done that already, and then click on Bake. The simulation is now done, and we can play our simulation by hitting the spacebar, and this is what it looks like. You will see the entire thing is filled up with particles, and it's not just the thin line at the top, and that looks pretty cool. Now for the particle, let's go ahead and restart the animation, press Shift A, and we'll add in a mesh and then an icosphere. With this icosphere selected, make sure you open up this panel and turn the subdivisions down to a value of 1. Then we can press G and X and move this over to the right. Now let's select our domain and go over to the particle system tab. Here we can see the particle system. Let's go ahead and select it and open up the render and the viewport display. We're going to click on render as halo to render as object. Now before we select our object, I am going to turn down the amount of particles in the viewport because this will really slow down the viewport and I want to be able to move fast. So for the amount right here, I'm going to bring that down to 10%. Then we will select the icosphere by hitting that eyedropper tool and selecting the icosphere. And there we can see it. Select it, scale it down until you get the appropriate size. Probably around there is good, I think. Keep in mind, if you render it with just 10% in the 3D viewport, it will only display 10% in the render as well. So what you need to do to actually display 100% is to turn it off in the viewport and bring this all the way up. The reason why I left it on and turned it at 10% is because we're going to work on the material real quick and I want to be able to see what I'm doing. Another thing you're going to want to check is show emitter. Make sure that is turned off so you won't see the cube but only the particles. Now let's go ahead and work on the material. But before we do that, we also need to uncheck show emitter so we can actually see the particles. Now if we go into solid view, we can see the domain is now gone and we'll be able to see inside to change the material for the particles. I'm also going to select this cube right here by selecting this one, yep, cube 001, and turning it off in the viewport. And I'm also going to turn it off in the rendered view. So enable that camera icon by hitting that drop-down menu and turning it off in the rendered view. Select your icosphere, press Z and go into material view. And if you don't see that, what you need to do is go underneath edit, preferences, and make sure key map, extra shading pie menu is turned on. Now we can work on the material. So go over to the material tab and click new. What I want for this material is the bottom of the particles to be a blue color, a dark blue, and it will lighten up as it gets higher. To do this, we're going to split the view and then change this over to the shader editor and then press N to close off that panel. I'm also going to render this animation using Eevee so the particle info node will not work. You can see here the particle info node. Normally I would use this, but since we're rendering with Eevee, it's not compatible. So what we're going to do instead is add in an object info node and place that over on the left. The next node we'll add is a gradient, so press Shift A, go to texture and gradient right here. Then Shift A, converter, color ramp. And then finally we'll add in a mapping node to change the location. Vector and then mapping node right here. Take the location and plug that into the vector, vector into the gradient, the factor into the factor of the color ramp, and then the color into the base color. Now we can see this is what it did, and it's currently not lined up. So what we need to do is change the rotation of the y-axis. If we bring this up to a value of 90, we can see that this is now working. It's a gray color here and then it turns to white. The location of the gradient we can change by moving the x, and we can drag this up till we get the black coming into our scene. Now currently this is a really harsh cutoff. You can see it's black here, then it immediately turns to white. This does not look very good, so we're going to fix this by bringing up the scale of the Y, the Z? Yes, of the Z axis. So bring this down to a lower number and we can see we have a better transition. Probably a value of 0.1, and then of course we need to change the location once again. Something like that. And we can see here that this is a much smoother transition. So what I did here was a negative 0.06, a 90 for the rotation, and then a 0.1 for the Z scale down here. If we go into front view, we can see this a little bit better. Look at that, much smoother. Now we can go over here and change the color. Now since we changed the color, we might need to play around with the Z location once again. So come back over to the mapping node and play around with this. And as you can see here, this looks a little bit better. I might change this to be a little bit of a lighter color to just get a smoother transition, something like that. And there we go. We now have a gradient. And if we play our simulation, we can see it's dark blue, becomes light blue up there, just like that. And that looks pretty cool. Now that we've worked on our material, let's go ahead and close off this panel and finish out our scene. So what I'll do first is select the particle system, go back over to the particle system tab, turn it off in the viewport and bring up the amount all the way up to 100 so now it will display the full particles. Next, I'll create a basic scene around our particle. I just added in a floor with a basic principled shader. I added a sun lamp with a strength of 4, and this should look pretty good in the render. So over in the render settings, what we're going to do is set the render amount to a value of 50 for the samples, and then in the output section, make sure you set an output right here of where you want your frames to go to. You should definitely not render this as a movie file just in case it crashes. So go ahead and find a folder. I'm just going to create a new one right here, call it tutorial. and I'll select it and then accept, and now every single frame will go into that folder. And down here in the timeline, you should also set this to 150. I forgot to do this in my render and I accidentally rendered out 100 frames extra. Then all you have to do is go up to your render and click on render animation. If you want to learn how to sequence this out in a movie file, I will link a video in the description of where you can learn how to do that. For now though, that is going to be it for this video. Thank you for watching. If you are new to the channel, make sure you click subscribe to stay notified whenever I upload a new Blender tutorial. And speaking of new tutorials, next week we're going to cover smoke guides in Manceflow. That will be a really cool tutorial, so make sure to look out for that. Thanks again for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.